But that that project of internment was also, we could say, a kind of liberal project, because the government intended it as this kind of laboratory to refashion or remake Asians from these aliens into model citizens. And one way they do that, they did that, was to encourage Japanese Americans to enlist for the United States military, right, to fight World War II for the United States. And so it's during World War II that there's a big PR campaign, actually, that celebrates Japanese Americans' heroism. And Japanese American leaders are actually able to leverage this military service for political gains, right? That is to argue that the Japanese exclusion laws should be repealed as rewards for the patriotism and bravery of Japanese American soldiers. The second way that the government tries to assimilate Japanese Americans is to, encourage them to resettle across the country, right? The idea is, instead of living all together as they did on the West Coast, if they spread out all over the Midwest and the Eastern Seaboard, that they could then sort of fade into the white middle class, right? So this project didn't exactly work out as the government planned, but but what's interesting in the 50s is there are a lot of stories in the media and also by social scientists really celebrating Japanese Americans for recovering from this trauma of internment. And that becomes a very important foundation for the model minority myth. Now, in the second example, we have the Chinese Americans. The Chinese also start to experience a very interesting turnaround in the 40s and 50s. Previously thought of as these suspect bachelor societies, who were opium smokers and doing all kinds of shady things, right? By the 40s and 50s, the media, social scientists, government officials started to celebrate the Chinese as having these exemplary families and households that were very orderly in gendered ways too. That the boys were raised towards breadwinning, the girls toward homemaking, and these households in American Chinatowns preserve traditional Chinese Confucian culture, okay? So what we have really after World War II is the prototypical tiger mom, okay? And really these stories, right, this idea of the tiger mom that I'm sure you guys all know about, that the Chinese have these well-behaved children, study hard, never get into trouble, get into Harvard and play the piano. All these kinds of stories actually didn't begin with a certain law professor that was at Yale, but actually started as early as the 1930s. And really, they originated in liberals' campaign to repeal the Chinese Exclusion Acts in the late 30s in World War II. And then they gained traction when there's a big juvenile delinquency panic in the 1950s. And so we even see New York City Congressman Arthur Klein praising the Chinese of New York in 1958. He said that troublemaking among Manhattan's Chinese were so low that the police don't even bother to keep figures on it. Right? And so Chinatown leaders themselves are very interested in kind of telling these stories of the model Chinese families, especially in the 1950s when there's an FBI immigration, an INS crackdown on unauthorized immigration in Chinatown that dates back to the 19th century, right? So this is seen as a way to diffuse that kind of racial suspicion of Chinese as, so-called illegal immigrants. Okay. And I'll just give you one more example, and that is the Hawaii statehood example. Now, in the 1940s and 50s, Hawaii, which was once an independent kingdom, became a territory of the United States, or a colony, if you will, in 1898. By the 1940s and 50s, there was a big push for Hawaii to become a state, right? A lot of folks actually thought this would help win the Cold War, again, part of that treatment of racial minorities better, right? Because Hawaii's population was largely Asian, supporters of statehood had to reassure the nation that admitting Hawaii to statehood would not introduce yet another race problem into American society, right? Remember, this is the 1950s, and the Southern Civil Rights Movement is going on. People like Senator Strom Thurmond, right, cannot imagine there ever being an Oriental state, right? It's too foreign, it's too colored to be American. So statehood champions work very hard and very successfully to recast Hawaii as a racial paradise, right? It's a diverse state. You can see here, this is a photo from Life magazine in 1948. And the point of this picture is to show how diverse and how harmonious Hawaii was, right? And you can see, very interestingly, people are holding up signs that, I guess, say their racial background. And I think a very important absence from this photo is any African Americans, right? There's no sign that says black, right? And I think that was very important to telling the story of Hawaii as a racial paradise. Black people did not conveniently fit into that story, right, in the 1940s.